Welcome to another episode of Software Explorations, Concepts, and Overviews. I am your host, Tech Coach Ralph. And in today's episode, we are going to continue with part three of diving into Docker. This should be the third and final episode in this little mini series. So, and what I'll do as well is I will put, I'll create a playlist where I can have these three videos specifically going through Docker. And then when we actually do a live stream dedicated to using the different components of Docker, then I can also put that live stream in that playlist as well. So look out for that playlist coming. Pretty much whenever this, when this video gets scheduled, it'll also be part of that Docker playlist, right? And if you've watched the previous part one and part two, let me know what you think. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask. If you think I missed something or I got something wrong, I am definitely open to feedback. Because we are here to learn. We're learning together. I've used Docker for quite a few years now, but by no means am I an expert in Docker at all. I've been able to use it for my particular needs and the work that I do, but there is so much more that I want to learn with Docker. And, you know, my plan is to learn it with you through live streams and, you know, just trying to build cool stuff, gain more knowledge and everything like that. But without further ado, if you are new to the channel, I would ask you to subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell so you know when we go live or when we drop a new video. And that way you can keep up with us and you can come along the journey for us, this fantastic ride that we're on to learn and grow together. Also, like the video, share the video with somebody who, you know, is in the field or and looking to grow, looking to learn. All right. So without further ado, like I said, let's get into our presentation. All right. So Docker part three. Let's do a quick recap of part one and then part two. So in part one, if you haven't seen it yet, I would highly recommend you go check it out. I will give a link to it right here somewhere. But part one, we spoke about what is containerization, why it is important, what is Docker, what are the key components of Docker, what is virtualization, and how Docker and containerization compares to virtualization. We spoke about the Docker architecture. We spoke about Docker images. And we spoke about Docker containers. So, like I said, if you have not seen part one yet and you would like to, go check it out. It's going to be part of the playlist. It's also going to be linked in the video. All right. So check it out and we can go from there. Now we get into part two. So a recap of part two. Last week we discussed about managing containers. We spoke about Docker Compose. We spoke about Docker networking, you know, how to get containers to talk to each other, how to get containers to talk to the outside world, how to get the outside world to talk to our containers. We spoke about Docker volumes, which is like our storage, you know, how we manage the storage for Docker, whether it's like internally or on a volume where the data can persist across other containers. We spoke about the Dockerfile for building Docker images, and then we concluded that. And today we are going to talk about use cases for Docker. We're going to talk about the Docker and DevOps. We're going to talk about the Docker ecosystem and the best practices for Docker. And then we will end our series. All right. So what are some use cases and examples? There are like, there's pretty much anything that you could do on a regular computer, you can do it or on a server, you can do it on Docker. There's an infinite amount of possibilities, but some that I have used. So using the Selenium grid with Docker, right? I remember there was a Docker image compose. It was called Selenium, right? And you could set up a whole Selenium grid, which would record video and do all this cool stuff. it was amazing. And then you can, and I use that so much to facilitate my testing needs. Then you can use Docker to set up an Nginx web server. And if you've seen me work on any of the Chaos Camp challenges, like the web UI automation challenge, that uses a Docker image using Nginx to set up a very basic web page where we use that to be able to do our testing. You can set up MongoDB, for instance. You can set up pretty much any type of database you can set up MongoDB, you can set up MySQL, you can set up MSSQL. All of those can be Dockerized. They're Dockerized images, and you can do that. And you see us use, like you've seen me, like if you, like mentioning Chaos Camp, it has in the instructions for the challenge how you would use Docker to build the image, right? Build the image locally, and then run the container from the image to be able to access it, like in the REST API challenge for Rock, Paper, Scissors game. It uses a Docker image to build that image, and then you run the container based off that image. So many endless possibilities that you can do with Docker. And this is like these four, super basic, just touching the, this is just tip of the iceberg, right? I remember if you followed along with the Airflow live stream, you saw how big that Dockerfile was, which would build the image, and then how big the Docker Compose file was, which would be setting up your containers. So many different possibilities that you can do with Docker. So let's talk about real quick Docker and DevOps. So Docker is a cornerstone of DevOps practices, simplifying application development, testing, and deployment while ensuring consistency, portability, scalability, and security. It allows DevOps teams to automate tasks, streamline processes, and deliver high-quality software with efficiency and agility. So, and let's just touch on a few of these points real quick, right? So about the consistency and portability, right? So the DevOps teams use Docker to create consistent environments for development, testing, and production. So in software development, we don't just have one environment. We have a production environment, of course, right? Where like the public can see it, but we also have a testing environment, we can have a development environment. And about the testing environment, could be your main branch, which is where it should be the same as your production environment. Maybe has a change that's about to go into production, but the development environment is what is currently being worked on, and it is like, it's not that stable, right? And then you can have like many different branches that are in development, and then you merge them into development, into the testing branch before they go to production. So with Docker, what works on a developer's laptop is highly likely to work the same way in other stages of the pipeline, ensuring consistency across the board. Docker images are portable, allowing teams to move applications between different environments with ease. And that is so important. And that's probably been one of the most challenging parts of software development and deployment in the past, right? And then continuous integration and continuous deployment, Docker is integrated into the CI/CD pipeline, automating the build, test, and deployment processes. Containers can be built and tested in isolation, and if successful, then they can be deployed to production environments with confidence, right? And then we can touch on like version control. Docker images are versioned, allowing DevOps teams to track changes over time. This facilitates rollbacks to previous versions if new images cause issues, ensuring versions control of both application code and its runtime environment. And then let's talk about a little bit of collaboration. Docker Hub and private Docker registries allows teams to share and distribute Docker images, fostering collaboration among team members. This ensures that everyone works with the same application component and dependencies. So just keeping things consistent so that we can easily work together, which is the goal as a software development team. We don't want any tension or anything like that. And then there is infrastructure as code, which is so important. Which reminds me of like, we're learning Terraform, And Terraform is another form of infrastructure as code, which can work with Docker and all of that good stuff. So Docker Compose and Docker Swarm, for example, can be defined as code in version controlled files. This shifts towards infrastructure as code makes it easier to manage and automate infrastructure configurations. And let's just touch on this one lastly, monitoring and management. DevOps teams use Docker monitoring tools to keep track of container performance, logs, and resource utilization. This information is crucial for optimizing application performance and troubleshooting issues. All right. So that is about Docker and DevOps. And now let's get into the Docker ecosystem. And we'll be starting off with our Docker ecosystem summary. So let's get into the ecosystem. So this is a summary of what we're going to talk about in regards to the ecosystem. We're going to have an overview of the ecosystem. Then we're going to get into what the Docker engine is, the Docker hub is. We already touched on Docker Compose, but we're going to see how that relates to the ecosystem. We're going to talk about Docker Swarm, Kubernetes, and networking and storage plugins for Docker, and then security tools, all right? So let's get into the ecosystem. So an overview of the ecosystem. The Docker ecosystem is, the Docker ecosystem at its core is like a big toolbox for building and running computer programs. It's not just Docker itself, it's all the extra tools and things that make Docker even more powerful. The one important tool in Docker toolbox is Docker Compose. It's like a magical spell that lets you run many Docker containers together, making it easier to set up complex applications, right? And like, if you haven't seen the Docker Compose yet, right? It is, it just makes everything come together. You can, with the networking and everything that you'd have to do manually to get Docker, like Docker containers, with the networking and the volumes and all that, custom images to work together, you can script it, right? And it might take you some time to script it, but it becomes reusable. And all you have to do after you have your Docker file created, Docker Compose up, and it does all its magic, right? To bring it up. And then once you're done with it, Docker Compose down and everything is torn down, right? And the good thing about it is it's so portable, because now let's say you create this Docker Compose file, right? You can send it to someone else. And then once they run it, it's going to do that magic for them, and it should work exactly like it worked for you. All right, so let's talk about the Docker engine. The Docker engine is the heart of Docker. It's like the core of an operating system, but designed for containers. The Docker engine runs containers and manages their lifecycle. All right, now Docker Hub. Think about Docker Hub like it's a huge library for containers. It's a place where you can find pre-built containers shared by others, all right? So we already mentioned Docker Compose, but let's talk about it a little bit more. So Docker Compose is like a conductor for a symphony of containers. It lets you define and run multi-container applications using a simple configuration file. So talking about multi-container applications, right? So think about it like this. We mentioned Nginx in our use cases, right? So you have a web server, Nginx. You can have a database, maybe MySQL or MongoDB, whatever it is that you're using. You can have another container for, who knows, right? And then you can have those containers working together. So let's say you have an API, right? An API running. You have a web server running, all of that. And you can have it say, when I make this requests to the API to create a new user, it will go into the other database, the MongoDB, for instance, right, which is a separate container, and it will put the user information, like it will create the record for that user, right, in the database. So now you have one container reaching out to the other container to do whatever it needs to do, and then now that container can send back a response to the web server container saying that it was created successfully and all of that, right? So, and that is pretty much how Docker Compose works, and then you can have the volumes in there where it's storing the data of the database, all of that, right? So, and with that, you can run it on a cloud environment where the Docker containers are living there, and they're doing what they need to do instead of, like, cause, you know, you're not going to be running a whole system based on your local machine, but it's going to be living in the cloud somewhere, and places like AWS, Azure, Google Cloud Platforms, and others would be the ones who are keeping those Docker containers up, and you're accessing those to do their thing, all right? So then we have Docker Swarm. When you need to manage a whole fleet of containers across multiple machines, Docker Swarm is your commander. It's like having a general overseeing of your troops. All right, so Docker Swarm, it just makes it where you can distribute it across multiple regions. All right, the Docker ecosystem, we're going to talk about Kubernetes and the Docker registry, right? So Kubernetes, think of Kubernetes as an advanced version of Docker Swarm. It's like the manager of a huge factory with thousands of machines and workers, right? So, you know, Kubernetes is Docker Swarm times 10. I tried to take a course on Kubernetes a couple of years ago. However, my computer was not powerful enough to handle it. But I will get back into it to, because like I'm saying, Docker and the way that it works with, just the way that the concept of Docker, right? It might not be Docker itself. It could be, you know, they can get competitors and stuff like that, or they probably already have competitors, but the concept of containerization is the future. And I always believe position yourself in the best place to win, right? So being able to know how containerization works and know how to use it, whether it's through Docker or other systems like it, other softwares like it, this is the key to job security and growth, all right? So Docker Registry now is, it's like your personal bookshelf. It's a place where you can store your own containers, control access, and share them within your organization or with a select group of people, right? And that is where, so let's say you create your own custom container, right? Where it has your image, or not only your own custom container, it can have, like, you have your container, it can have your, like, you have your images built where you can create new containers from that. And you don't necessarily have to host it in the Docker Hub, especially if you want it to be private and secure. There's other, like, there's Amazon who can host images that you can use to build containers and things like that from. So you can have different registries. You can even have a Docker registry on your personal computer as well. But the idea and the concept is to you can store your own containers, and you can say who has access to it, who doesn't have access to it, and with, you know, within your workplace or with certain groups of people based on the permissions that you give, right? So it doesn't necessarily have to be public. What you can do is you can build your images and your containers based off the public images, and then you add your own customizations, your own, however you want it to work, and then you make that private to a select group of people. All right, so now we're talking about networking and storage plugins and security tools. So networking plugins help containers communicate with each other or the outside world. Storage plugins allow you to manage how data is stored within the container. So that goes about the networking, to, like I was mentioning, Docker containers talking to other Docker containers and talking to the outside world, as well as the outside world talking to your containers, right? They're set up for that. And then the storage plugins is related to the volumes, where how data is stored, how it's shared across containers, how they have access to it, all right? And then lastly, we have our security tools. There are various tools and best practices to ensure your containers are protected. This includes scanning images for vulnerabilities, access control, and secret management. And one of the biggest problems that companies will have is they don't update their systems on time. So, like, for instance, let's say you're using Jenkins, right, for CI/CD. and it's on Docker. And now a new version of Docker comes out, right? Let's say three new versions, but you're still three versions back. You have to make sure you're looking at why these versions were updated, the new features, the security patches that were done, because I don't like being so far back in our versioning. And then you risk security vulnerabilities, hacks, and stuff like that. It's important that we try to stay close to the recent version, even if it's not always a recent version, because you know those can have bugs and stuff, but stay close to it, stay close to the stable version. And with Docker, it makes it pretty simple to upgrade, because you can bring down a container and then you can bring up a new container and just map it to the same volume. And then once that new container comes up, it should be able to use, once that new container comes up, it should be able to have that same data. It's like it should be a seamless process, right? And that's one of the cool things about Docker. All right, so what are the best practices for Docker? Keep it clean, use smaller images, right? And then update, like I just mentioned, update regularly. Write good instructions for how, like, and writing good instructions is not only for other people, it's also for yourself, because you can come back to it 6 months later and you're like, you have no idea what's going on. And for me, like, sometimes I'll come back to it like after the weekend, I'm like, what in the world is I doing? Writing good instructions, at least like saying where you left off, so you can have a good idea of where you're going, right? Limit permissions of who can do what to it. Have good security management, monitor the container, see what the health levels is, back up your data, right? Because data management is so important. If you lose it, it might be very impactful, and protect your secrets. All right, so just a quick recap. In part one, we went through containerization, why it's important, what is Docker, the key components of Docker, what virtualization is. We talked about Docker versus virtualization, the Docker architecture, Docker images, and Docker containers. In part two, we talked about managing your containers, building images and containers, storing your data, and what the best practices are. And in conclusion, for part three, we went over the use cases, Docker and DevOps, the ecosystem for Docker, and the best practices. All right. So if you have any questions, feel free to drop a comment in the chat and I will get back to you. I make sure that I read through all the comments and I try to answer them as much as possible. If I don't have the answer, I will make sure that I find the answer. Sometimes I might decide that a video answer is the best response to it. So I will go ahead and create a video to respond and give some feedback on that. So let's go back here. And I hope that you enjoyed this. I hope you enjoyed the three-part series on Docker. I hope you found it very informative, and I hope that it motivates you to dive into something new, dive into Docker to find out how it works and why it's important. I hope I was able to help you with that as well. So let me know what you think, and we'll go from there. If you found this video informative, please subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell so you can know every time that we go live. Like the video, share the video, comment, whatever the case may be, and we can go from there, right? So until next time, everyone, this has been another episode of Software Explorations, Concepts and Overviews, hosted by yours truly, Tech Coach Ralph. Until next time, this is Tech Coach Ralph signing off.
If you enjoyed the fascinating information shared in this video and you want more, be sure to hit the subscribe button to Tech Coach Ralph to be notified for new videos.